Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast as we wander towards episode 200. And speaking of wandering, I am joined on this edition. I don't know if I've introduced myself. My name is Billy, as always. I'm joined on this edition by the Wanderer, Michael Brian Frank. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Billy. It's an honour to be on this show. I've actually been wanting to do one of these for a long time now, and I'm glad we finally got around to it. I appreciate everything that you do for Scottish wrestling, all the coverage that you do for wrestlers, the coverage that you do for promotions. You know, it's a good thing you are doing. So it's an honour to be on the show today. Thanks for having me.
Flattery will get you everywhere on this podcast, so that's great. you're definitely... I mean, when we started this podcast, it was, like everyone else's. When I started this podcast, it was like during the pandemic, so you were kind of a bit more inactive at that point. But when you came back, I was I'm going to have to try and get the Wanderer on at some point, just because I want to know more about, because you're like very young, but you've got the entrance theme and that of something that's way older than, I think, even me. So we're definitely going to dive into
that. I think the song literally came out. The year my dad was born, and my dad was born in 1961. So that's how old the song is, and my dad's about 61 now. So it's an old song, but it's a really good song, I must say.
We'll dive into that in a bit. We'll go for the classic questions that we start off with most podcasts. And I'm seeing this room is boiling because I've steamed up my glasses already. So how did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment you got into it as a fan? What got you hooked?
Well, Billy, from what I can remember, I remember when I was younger, I'd say I was around 6 years old. My big brother was into wrestling. He had all the figures and stuff, but that was the time that he was growing out of wrestling. So my dad kind of gave me his figures and I started playing with him. I remember the first figure I had, it was Batista. And it was the Jax, Ruthless Aggression or Adrenaline, whatever they called them. It was one of the ones where he was wearing the white trunks. And it was actually my favourite figure, still my favourite figure to this day. And then I finally watched wrestling. The first match I can remember watching, it was No Way Out 2007. It was The Undertaker and Batista versus Shawn Michaels and John Cena. It was leading up to WrestleMania 23. That's the first match I remember watching. And as soon as I saw Batista, I just took a liking to him. And straight away, I took a liking to Batista. I was absolutely obsessed with Batista. I'd say he's probably one of my idols, and still to this day, my idol.
So have you still got that figure? Or is it one that's went away?
I've not got it anymore.
I don't know for yourself, but if my first figure was, this is going to age me terribly in comparison, because Batista 2006, 2007, my first action figure was Draws. was a bone crunching Draws. So it was.
I remember them.
The ones that you just like moved it slightly and it made like a clicking noise in the elbows and the knees and stuff.
They were kind of rubber feeling. Those figures, I remember them.
A few of them. It fell apart. The hands came off eventually, and it was thrown away. And every time I go on eBay or something, I keep an eye on them. Like, I'm not going to spend mental amount of money, but if I ever spot one, I'm wanting it just so I can have it in my background.
Definitely. I'm the exact same. If I ever see that Batista figure again, you best believe that I'm going to get it, and it's going to go up in one of my cabinets or something.
I know, it's one of those weird things. Like, I'm noticing now for younger wrestlers that I'm speaking to, that it's not always wrestling, the actual wrestling that gets folk into it. For yourself, it was the figures. For others, it seems
no, video games. It was the figures, and I was just amazed by the action figures. And then, obviously, I get shown a match, and I instantly just took a liking to it. It was amazing, honestly. I've had a great childhood with professional wrestling as a fan. My mum and dad always always looked after me. They gave me a good upbringing. They took me to all the shows. They took me to Comic Cons to meet wrestlers. You know what I mean? They've done a lot to make my childhood a good childhood.
They encouraged it.
They encouraged my passion. They still to this day encourage my passion. So I thank my mum and dad for everything to do with that.
So who was the first one you met? Who's the first wrestler you met then?
John Morrison in 2011, I believe. It was John Morrison. He was doing a signing. It was when WWE were in Brayhead Arena, and John Morrison was doing a signing in A1 Comics. A1 Comics would basically do signings anytime WWE was over. There was always a signing there. But John Morrison was the first wrestler I ever met. It was cool. I couldn't believe it.
Were you quite confident, kid, when it came to meeting wrestlers, or was it just one of those starstruck moments?
Not at first, but as I started meeting more wrestlers, I get more confident speaking to wrestlers and stuff. Like, to be honest, I think I just done a lot of wrestlers' heads in with the amount of questions I asked them. my confidence just got a lot better as I met more wrestlers. It was amazing. That's what I remember. John Morrison's the first one I met, and I was so nervous. I just remember being so nervous meeting him. I didn't even know what to say to him. He wasn't even a wrestler I liked as well. Like, watching him on TV, I didn't really care about him. But obviously, when I met him, I'm like, "Oh my God, there's John Morrison!" And it was amazing.
I absolutely understand that, because when I met Braun Strowman, did a signing up in Aberdeen, and I got my wife's pal. They lived in Aberdeen, so I got them to get me one of the wristbands and meet them at
Smiths
and that. So I had no intention to go to the show because the tickets are expensive, so I wasn't going to go to the show myself. But
I'm not really a fan of going to WWE house shows now. Just kind of grew out of it, if you get me.
I would like to say I do get you, but if I got the opportunity to go, I probably still would.
Yeah, that's fair enough. That's really fair enough.
But yeah, meeting Braun Strowman, I was like, I've no interest in Braun. I've had a Braun Strowman t-shirt because I won it in a competition. So I was like, I'll wear that. That's fine. So all in all, meeting him and having the merch cost me nothing, and it was nice. But it was just one of those days. It's like, why not meet Braun Strowman?
Why not? Definitely.
So did you ever have that? I mean, you're still, was it 2006? You say you started, and you're about six, so you're what, 22 now ish.
I'm 21 now.
21.
I'm 21 now. I'm 22 in July. So yeah, it's crazy. And do you know something? I remember all this like it was yesterday. I think the years have just flew in. My childhood just flew in. Honestly, if I could go back, I would. I miss it so much. It sucks being an adult.
As a 33-year-old in July, I'm with you there.
You look good for 33, to be fair.
To be honest, if you saw last week's episode, what it's going to go out the week before, it was before I actually trimmed my beard. I looked 33, but now I've actually given myself a trim, and I look 30. I'll be happy with 30. If I got ID'd, I'd be ecstatic. Did you ever have a lapse point then? Was there ever a point where you kind of went out of wrestling, or has it always been a constant?
I'd say it was always an on and off thing. There was certain time periods where I wouldn't watch it. It was just really, you know, you get that with WWE. You know, there's times where you watch WWE, then there's times where you don't watch WWE because it just gets boring, then it picks up again. It's just kind of on and off relationship of football wrestling. If I started watching it, but I'd still say that I always loved it. Like I always watched WrestleMania and the Royal Rumble. Like, no matter what, whether I liked it or I didn't, I always made sure that I would watch it again. For, you know what I mean, just to watch those shows. You know, I think everyone watches WrestleMania. Even people that don't like wrestling watch WrestleMania. Because it's just that big event.
That's it. This is the time where people get into wrestling, I think. Royal Rumble, WrestleMania. I mean, obviously, this will be coming out after WrestleMania. So oh, I can't believe the Undertaker did that 450 splash. But this is the time people get into it. It's Rumble, Mania, and then if you don't get hooked at this point,
SummerSlam, Survivor Series.
Yeah, there's always next year. That'll be your cycle round again to come back into it. So of course Batista, he left to go do Guardians of the Galaxy and be an amazing movie star. John Morrison, you weren't a particular fan of, but I assume you had a little bit of a soft spot because you met him, and the ones you do meet, you develop that soft spot for. But was there anyone else who kind of was your guy or your girl in wrestling?
Well, when Batista left in 2010, well, I'd say I was on and off. I didn't watch it as much until 2010. 2010 is where I would tune in every single week. I would watch Monday Night Raw. The next day after it was on, my dad had Sky TV in his house, so I would always make sure I watched Raw, SmackDown, and the pay-per-views, obviously. But 2010, I would say, was the peak year for me getting into wrestling. You know, that's when I became crazy for wrestling. And that was the time where Batista has heel run as WWE champion. They'd done the feud with John Cena. That's when I loved Batista the most. Like, the bad guy Batista was my favourite Batista. And honestly, I was gutted when he left. Like, I wish he stayed longer and done more feuds and stuff in that run. But I suppose he just wanted to leave and go and do his own thing. But I remember younger and watching him quit, and I was absolutely gutted. I think I was greeting because of it. But after that, I kind of took a liking to, obviously, the Nexus getting introduced. I loved the Nexus. I was always that wrestling fan that liked the bad guys and hate the good guys. You always get one fan like that. But I was that guy. I always cheered the bad guys and booed the good guys. But guys like CM Punk, I like CM Punk's heel run with the Straight Edge Society and stuff. CM Punk, I took a liking to as well. That was sort of after Batista left.
I mean, I suppose because your top headlining act always was going to be John Cena versus somebody. So of course, John Cena was the reason in the show on the wrestling why Batista was gone. So no wonder you were like, no, I'll support everyone who's against John Cena because he.
No, that was literally I hated John Cena, like proper hated him, like booed him all the time, and I would always like throw his figures about and stuff. I never liked John Cena. I was always rooting for the other guy when they would face John Cena. But when John Cena started to leave, or started to like die down a bit and only appear every now and then, that's when I realised that, you know, something, he is one of my idols because, do you know what I mean? I don't know the right way to word this, but I didn't appreciate John Cena enough until he's not about all the time. And that was amazing. That was an amazing one for me. That's when I realised that, you know...
Yeah, you actually liked him deep down inside.
I liked him deep down inside. Like, you know what I mean? I liked booing him.
I like that your reason for disliking him, though, isn't because the usual internet stuff, which is like, oh, he was shoved down your throats and all that kind of stuff. You didn't like him because you were at the age to enjoy wrestling and he got rid of your guy. And so that's why you do not like him.
That's why I really hated him. The way I looked at it, he made my favourite wrestler quit wrestling. That's the way I looked at it. And it was shocking for me. I absolutely loved Batista. And the fact that he left in 2010, I just blamed all that on John Cena. Obviously, I thought wrestling was still real at that point.
Mm-hmm.
But I was absolutely gutted.
That's the bit I miss about wrestling is not knowing, is just enjoy it. Well, I mean, that's why I try to watch wrestling anyway, try to enjoy it as a show and a performance and an actual a legit thing. But I do miss that when I was that age and just going, this is real.
No, they were the best times. Yeah, you know what I mean? Life was just shit, and then, you know what I mean, there's wrestling there to keep you happy. That's they were the days, man, where you know that wrestling was fake. You always thought it was real. Like those were like, but I wish it was still that. I wish I was still that type of fan. But I think the internet's ruined wrestling. Oh, yeah. To be honest, I think the internet's exposed the business too much. Because that's when I realised that wrestling was all predetermined.
That's it. I mean, I, for life of me, I try to avoid things like your quote unquote dirt sheets, because it just sucks the enjoyment out of it. But how did you get? So how did you go from that going, right, I'm watching this, Batista's best. I don't know if we're gonna get a Batista couch somewhere in the corner here. I've mentioned both of us mentioning him so much. But how did you go from that going, right, I'm gonna give this a go then. I'm gonna try the wrestling.
Well, I'll tell you the story of how I started training. It's quite a long one, but you know, they all say, oh, don't do backyard wrestling and stuff, but in my opinion, you're not a real wrestling fan if you never wrestled your pals at your back garden when you were a kid. That's honestly the way I look at it. So me and my friends, we grew up in Rolgan. I stayed in a block of flats, and out the back garden of the flats, we used to wrestle each other. We used to throw ourselves off bin sheds. We used to put ourselves through boxes. Like anything we found that we could use as a weapon, we would use it. We used to always go into shops. Do you know how those wee sort of foil containers you get for food?
Yeah.
Like the big ones, we used to use them. And you know what I mean? Fucking ourselves with them, they're the heads and that. That's what we used to do. We used to go mental. Out of our back garden, wrestling. So I literally done that from I was about 8 years old till I was about, I'd say, 12. That's when we started dying down a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's when I started training wrestling. So I started training wrestling in 2015. I was 13 years old. I trained at a school in Airdrie. It was run by TJ Rage. I trained there. That's when I started wrestling, training. And I was there for about maybe 3 years before I got my first match. Because I was obviously young at the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in my opinion, the minimum age you should be starting to wrestle on a show is 16 years old. Mm-hmm. I know 11-year-olds that have legit. I know people have made their debut when they were 11 years old and stuff, which I think is crazy, to be honest. It's not really safe.
Mm-hmm.
Let's be honest, it's not really safe for a boy that young to be wrestling a show. For a lot of reasons, it's not safe.
For a liability standpoint as well, because I mean, 16. I mean, you can sugarcoat it, but that's technically some people start considering 16-year-olds as adults. So that's when they have a liability on their own body. But if they're under 16, I would say even there's like maybe a 16, 17 would be a kind of maturity point. But I think before then, you're still growing. So if you're getting thrown,
no, definitely. I'd even say 16 and 17 is a push.
Mm-hmm.
Is a push, but you know, a lot of places don't take people in until they're 16, which is fair enough. But there's still other ways for kids to do wrestling training. There's still other ways for them to have fun and enjoy it. So that's what we do at Ravy Davies Glasgow School of Wrestling. He runs a 5 to 11-year-old class, and it's literally the most fun you could ever have. Like when I was a kid, I wish I went to these classes
mm-hmm.
because, you know, you're just having fun. We play wrestling tag. There's a game Ravy Davy made up called Survivor Series, and it's like the best game ever. Like he's an absolute genius for coming up with this idea. It's basically you split into two teams. You've got about 6 hoops, and you've got beanbags, and you've got cones. So you've got 2 cones in the ring on either side. You throw the rings, try to get the rings on the cone. If you land that ring on the cone, you immediately win. But if you don't, you need to run over to the bean bags and throw the bean bags on the outside, the cone that's on the outside of the ring. And if you knock that over before the other team, you win. And if you win, you get to do a finisher on the dummy in the crash mat. And then the other guys are eliminated. It's honestly the best, most genius idea I've ever heard. And it's amazing. I can't believe he came up with that. It's actually worked.
I'm liking hearing about these kids' classes now, because I was speaking to Mike Musso recently, and his class is like, he shows you how to do the moves, but he treats it like it's legit. So it's like, he shows you how to do it, but not do it at the same time.
I
like that kind of thing. And of course, when you're old enough for that to find out, then you move on to the next kind of class. And I like seeing the videos that Ravy Davey puts out. I spoke to him as well recently. And
no, definitely. I actually listened to that podcast this morning. It was a really good listen. He never put me over, the cunt.
Well, I mean, you have the option of not putting him over, but I think you kind of just did by calling him a genius. So
No, he is. I've got to say that if it wasn't for Ravy Davey, I don't know where I'd be the day in wrestling. He's took a chance on me. He's opened up his training school. He's took a chance on me. He's looked after me for community pro wrestling shows. And to be honest, he's got me over in community pro wrestling. Like, the CPW fans that travel about the shows, they know who I am. Mm-hmm. We just done a show in Drumchapel on Friday night there. I wrestled Jason Reed. What a match it was. It was really good, a lot of fun. Jason Reed's a hell of a competitor as well. I can definitely see him going places one day. With the talent he's got, he's really good. It was really easy to wrestle, but he was really good. But anyways, he's got me over on CPW. We done the show in Drumchapel, and there was a fan in the crowd that was wearing a Wanderers jacket with the sunglasses. And I'm like, no way, man, no way is this real. Like, somebody's legitimately wearing my gear, because they're that much a fan of me. It brought a tear to my eye, to be honest, because it makes me feel like I'm doing something right. I was blown away by it. It was amazing. It's amazing what CPW does for wrestlers. There's definitely something special starting up here in Scotland, and I think community pro wrestling's going to be everywhere soon. Honestly, I believe it will.
But that's it. When you're talking about like bringing a tier to your eye, of course, we'll go back a little bit then to your debut. So that was 2018. I've got it written down as, so I don't know.
It was 2018. I think it was May the 25th, 2018. It was an academy. It was like a trainee show. Just a small show that's only for friends and family, the trainees in the school. And 2018. It's mad that that's... Is that 6 years ago? Is it 5 years ago?
Five.
So that's 5 years ago since I first debuted in a show. And it's flown since then.
So you had 2 years of wrestling, just about a year and a half, maybe. Of course, the 2020 arrived, and you know that was the whole thing. So what was it like finally being the guy watching the shows to being on the shows? And was the Wanderer always in the back of your mind? How did you kind of morph into that?
Well, the Wanderer was kind of always in the back of my mind. Mainly because I like the song. Don't know if you've heard the song yourself. It's very catchy. I just took a liking to it right away, and I just thought I can make a wrestling character out of this. Then I soon learned that there was a film called The Wanderers. I watched it, and you know what I mean? It just gave me even more ideas to do with this character. So I pretty much just stole this character from a film, but... Oh, well, the way I look at it, makes the film relevant because it's a film from 1975, I believe.
And as you were saying beforehand, the song's from 1961.
So it's an old song. I like the whole classic, the classical type of character, classical type of wrestling character. I've always wanted to portray something like that. So it's good that it's actually working now and people are starting to recognise the character and starting to take a liking to it. So it's paid off, definitely. But I always took a liking to the song The Wanderer. I thought I could make a character out of it. So I just went for it in my debut. And I love singing the song, so I thought, why not just use that as my gimmick? I just come out and sing The Wanderer. So I was wanted to do as a heel character first. I done a few shows as heel doing it. And I actually got cheered. So that's when I realised that it's maybe doesn't work me being a heel doing this character, because people actually like me singing the song. So I have been a face ever since, and I do not plan on turning heel ever.
I'm trying to think of who else. I mean, of course, in the wider scope of wrestling, you have things like folks singing along to Judas for Chris Jericho, doing fandangoing, and Scottish wrestling, it would be Jackie Polo as well. You had folks singing Scott Walker's Jackie while he was coming to the ring, while he was singing it as well.
I literally used to be obsessed with that song because of Jackie Paul. Because I used to go to all the wrestling shows. I was a fan of all these guys, all these top names in ICW. Like, I looked up to them, they were idols to me. I've not even actually told you how I got into Scottish wrestling.
I just told you when I started
training. I may as well just get into that.
If it's
all right with yourself.
Absolutely.
Right, so ICW done a documentary in 2014 on the BBC. I listened to the podcast with Ravy Davey. Ravy Davey's going to say, I'm going to say the exact same thing as what he said. I watched the ICW documentary and the first person I saw was Grado, and I was absolutely blown away. I was just blown away by Grado. The guy doesn't look like a wrestler. Mm-hmm. Like, you wouldn't think, if you walked by him in the street and never knew who he was, you wouldn't think he's a wrestler. I was just blown away. He was just funny. I just took a liking to him straight away, and I thought, you know something, I want to be like him. Like, I want to be the next Grado. That's, and it's still kind of my thought process, but I'm kind of more in the mind of being the first Wanderer, but that was always my goal. I want to be the next Grado. I took a liking to Grado straight away, and that's when I started following Scottish wrestling, because I never knew about Scottish wrestling. Like, I knew there was Scottish wrestling shows and all that, but I just thought Scottish wrestling was rubbish. Like, the real wrestlers are WWE wrestlers. But when I actually got introduced to it and actually watched it, and I was blown away. I'm like, this is the best thing ever. Like, I started liking Scottish wrestling better than I liked WWE. So I went to all the shows, I went to BCW, I went to SWA. I pretty much went to every promotion that I could. Any wrestling show that was on, like, I would look up wrestling shows and I would try my best to go to them. I was a big follower of Scottish wrestling for a good few years until I started training. That's correct, until I started training.
I was about to say, like, I can't believe when you mentioned Grado, was like, of all the people I could have thought of for folk chanting theme tunes to them, how did I not think of Grado in that moment? Because, of course, everybody, regardless, even now, he's been going for well over 10 years now, and he's people still sing along to Like a Prayer.
That's what I want with the Wanderer. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That's how I looked up to Grado, because he came out to a catchy song, a really good song, you know what I mean, that everybody likes, and you know what I mean, it kind of made him who he was. Like, if Grado doesn't come out to Like a Prayer, in my opinion, he's not Grado. It's just not the same. Like, I remember he's came out to different tunes in ICW and stuff, like, because he couldn't use Like a Prayer on TV or that, so I've seen him come out to other songs and I'm just like, it's not the same, man. It's just not the same at all. Like,
yeah.
The full Grado experience, Like a Prayer, comes with it.
Absolutely. And, but yeah, absolutely. Because it just pumps up the crowd straight away. And for yourself, that's the plan. Once you come out to the Wanderer, everyone's all hyped. They're ready. They've sung along to a good tune, and they're like, right, I'm ready for some wrestling. Let's do some wrestling now. So it's a good plan, and not many people do it at the moment, and for whatever reason. It always works. Always, if you have a catchy theme tune, it always theme tune entrance tune, it always works. Because I mean, for up here,
no, definitely. I think the theme song makes the wrestler just as much as everything else. I think the theme song is probably most important.
Absolutely. So you started wrestling in 2018, arrived, you had your first couple matches, and then a year and a half later, there was no wrestling anymore because of a pandemic and then everything that happened during. So you took an extended break from that point, from what I understand, from what I remember seeing at the time.
I'll be open and honest. You know what I mean? People might not take it the right way, and that doesn't bother me in the slightest, because my views are my own. It was just all the stuff that happened, the speak out movement, all the abusers, the paedophiles that are still kicking about in wrestling, and you know, everybody thinks it's everybody, no one's really saying anything about it. You know, that's what put me off Scottish wrestling. I just had no intention of coming back. I didn't know where to train. I didn't know who to trust. You know, it was just one of the ones. It was a mental thing inside of me that I just, you know, it was playing along for a couple of years. I just had no intentions of going back. I just didn't want to be a part of. I just didn't want to be a part of it, because of all that. It just really put me off.
Yeah, it broke a lot of people, especially broke the guys that the school you were at as well, because I've spoken to quite a few of them, and that is the case. They had to try and find somewhere else to go, and it was like
there was just nowhere else.
Would there be a stink on them because they were training here, and it's just
that that's really it. Like you just don't know where to train, because you know there's people that are still willing to work for these guys and work with them, and it's just wrong, to be honest. I don't know how people aren't taking a stance to it.
That's it. I mean, there's only so much we
just confuses me to this day, but yeah, that's.
I was gonna say, for as much as we could do, we just don't. We try not to cover them, and I think that's as much as that as power as we have. But it is
definitely
just shocking seeing some of the shows going up. But come on. It's like being invited on Facebook to these shows, have a look at their heading or their poster, and I go, no. No, I'm not publicising it, so no.
it's really no right, to be honest, and the fact that a lot of these places are running shows in fucking primary schools, and they're getting away with it. They're literally getting away with it, and I honestly it fries my brain that these guys are getting away with running shows in primary schools for what they've done. Like, they shouldn't be near a school. I just blows my mind. That's all I've really got to say about that.
Yeah.
It put me off wrestling for a long time. But I had intentions of going back to wrestling because, you know, Lou King Sharp started his own training school. And I know Chris is a great guy. Lou, he's a great guy, and he's a great coach as well. Like, I've learned a lot of things off him, anything I've been taught off him. So he opened his own school at Iron Girders Gym every Monday from 7 to 9 for anybody that's looking to get some good training in. A few of my pals have been going there, you know, like the big strong man, Stone Malone, Ruby Roberts, people like that. They've obviously mentioned about the dojo to me and stuff, so I thought I'd go give it a try. That's where it all kicked off again. I seen Ravy Davey was opening up his own school as well. I knew Davey when I was wrestling before. I got along with him well. I said to him, I'm going to come try this out. He's like, aye, come down and that. And I went down, had a lot of fun. Everybody's brand new. And aye, that's here we are. Here we are. It all kicked off from there.
But that's it. When you're speaking about looking sharp, I mean, of course, after everything happened, we won't labour on this because there's ranting podcasts elsewhere, and I think if we start ranting and joining in, it's probably going to
not going to
help things. No. But I've got like a wee short list of wrestlers that I trust now. Well, I have to try and trust and right, if they're working this show, then I'm comfortable with promoting that show on the website and stuff like that. And Lou's one of them. He's definitely, because he's not.
No, he's one of the good guys. Mm-hmm. Lou and Ravy Davey, they're the good guys in wrestling. They're two good guys, I'd definitely say, you know what I mean, that you can trust.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. But so we do have a question about Glasgow School Wrestling, so I'll just get it up here on Instagram. They asked to remain anonymous, but just what's it like training at the Glasgow School of Wrestling? So you've kind of went into it, but what's it kind of like getting yourself prepared through the Glasgow School of Wrestling?
It's amazing. I actually help out coaching now in the Glasgow School of Wrestling, in the kids' classes. I basically just help out, take finishers off the kids, get them full of rules and stuff. Mm-hmm. I have fun with them in that. It's a good laugh. It's amazing to see how much they've came out of their shell since they've started training. I remember how shy they all were when I first came in. Davey first introduced me to them. They were all dead shy, but now they're all right out of their shell and they all have a laugh and stuff. And they're all fans of myself as well. Like, they come to the shows and they cheer me on and stuff. And they keep asking me, when am I getting T-shirts and stuff as well? So I've kind of built a fan base through Glasgow School of Wrestling, which is amazing. I love doing it. I love training there. I'm there every single weekend. Whether that's helping with the kids' class or helping with the adults' class, I'm there all the time now, and I'm having fun doing it. I'm living my dreams. Everyone that trains at Glasgow School of Wrestling, they're all a great bunch of people. And I hope they're listening to this because, you know what I mean, they deserve all the credit in the world. They're the best team about. They're the greatest environment around, and there's no better.
Excellent. So we'll do a couple more questions. We'll get through, and we can speak about actual pro wrestling. So that's kind of
all right. No worries.
We'll do about. So we've got Waldo asking how are you recovering from your CPW leg injury after your match at Drumchapel on Friday.
My leg injury. No, that was that must have been the Govan show. Did they say Drumchapel on Friday?
Oh, I just said after his match on Friday, and it was sent 18 hours ago, so I was, oh, that would have been, aye, that would have been before. I don't know, my brain's melted here. Leg injury, though, whatever it was.
No, and basically what happened was at the Govan show, Ravy Davey introduced me at the interval. I came out, took photos with the fans with the CPW belt, which was a good laugh. I really enjoyed doing that. Anytime the opportunity comes to do that again, you best believe I'm going to be there. So I took photos with the fans. Then after it, I went on and sang a song to my girlfriend who was at the merch table. Ravy told me to sing a song, and then basically I'll go back and then he'll get me back out and I'll sing The Wanderer. So what I done was I sang Elton John, Are You Ready For Love? To her, just to embarrass her, and I got the crowd chanting Lara, and it was amazing. Honestly, they were loud and they were rowdy for The Wanderer. It was honestly the best feeling I've ever felt. Like, one of the best nights of my life, I'm not going to lie. The reaction the Govan crowd gave me that night was unreal. But anyways, I went on, sang The Wanderer. I get jumped behind by Eli Bulwark and Thatcher Wright, the Thatcher's Cabinet. Davey introduced me as his tag team partner for the Govan gang fight versus Factions cabinet at the end of the show. So I was announced as a tag team partner. Went on, sang the Wanderer. They came back, they helped me from behind. Eli Bulwark helped me with his... he helped me with his... what do you call it? The...
It's like a nightstick.
The police...
The baton.
He helped me with that in the back of my leg, and it injured my knee for a few weeks. But I took me out of action for the main event. And I've recovered fine from it. And Drumchapel was my first match back. I had to miss the Burnout show because of it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm doing fine now. My knee's amazing. I'm fit as anything, probably in the best shape of my life, physically and mentally. And I came back Friday night, Drumchapel, had a great match with Jason Reed. Unfortunately, I lost, but there's no shame in losing to somebody like him. He's... Mm-hmm. He's fucking killing it, you know. He's got to be everywhere.
Generally, he's a name that I'm keeping a lookout when they're doing like NXT Europe and stuff like that. He's a guy that I'm just
if there's two people in Scottish wrestling that I'm confident will get signed, the WWE, AEW, Japan, wherever, any big company, the two names I'd say that are going to make it are Jason Reed and Leighton Buzzard.
Mm-hmm.
The two of them are superstars.
We're quite lucky in Scotland at the moment. We've got like Jack Morris being, of course, in Noah as well.
I've seen that, yeah. That's amazing.
We're fair branching out again. And it's just, yeah, it's a very exciting talent, time.
The best talent in the world are in Scotland. WWE just proves that, right? You've got Drew McIntyre, you've got Nikki Cross, you've got Wolfgang, you've got the Coffee Brothers, they're all killing it. Viper as well, Piper Niven, mm-hmm. They're all killing it. Scottish wrestling is the best thing going right now. The future is Scottish wrestling.
Absolutely. So we've got a couple of our questions. We've got one from Big Ross Hauser, which I'm very intrigued by. I just put, ask him what his opinion on onions and mushrooms are.
I was actually expecting a stupid question like that from someone that knows me. I just don't like onions and mushrooms. Like, I don't know how to explain it. Like, I don't mind onions as much. Like, see if there's onions in my chicken curry. Like, I don't mind it, but mm-hmm. Like, I don't know. I hate it. Like, see people that get their own sausage with onion in it. Like, why? Why are you doing that? I just don't understand that. It's just disgusting.
See, I'm with you with the mushrooms. I find the texture so weird. It is, like, if it's fried, as in caramelized, fuck, I'm all right with it.
Oh, no,
you don't taste it.
No, mushrooms are just... you're a nonce if you like mushrooms. I'm sorry, but you need to get fucking seen. They're disgusting. Onions... onions I don't mind as much, but mushrooms I fucking hate them. Like, if mushrooms were a person, I'd kick fuck at them.
that's the tagline for the episode. If you like mushrooms, you're a nonce. Fair.
But onions I don't mind as much, but mushrooms are disgusting. Fuck that, man. Definitely.
So weird thing to kind of to pivot now about you hating mushrooms is, of course, Attitude Pro Wrestling. So they're coming to Rother Glen May 5th, for Ruggy Mania.
Yeah.
Of course, you've got a big hand in Attitude Pro Wrestling. Why do you set up Attitude Pro Wrestling, and what's the story behind it?
Well, this goes back to the Backyard Wrestling. But our backyard promotion, if you would like to say, it was called Attitude Pro Wrestling. Pretty much we used to take it to the next level. We got our own title belt made and everything for it. Like, we literally went all out with it when we were young boys, hoping one day that it would become a reality. one day. I always had faith in myself to make this a real thing. So that's when it started. When we were young kids, 8, 9 years old, that's where it all started. So it was me, and I don't know if you've seen the poster, but I've got Rolgan's own Frankie Richards on the show. Frankie Richards is probably my best friend. Me and him grew up together. We both loved wrestling. That's how we were best friends, obviously. Like, we just loved wrestling. That's how we connected with each other. We watched all the pay-per-views up each other's houses. You know what I mean? We done everything together. And we used to throw each other about our back gardens. But we had us and all our pals doing it, but a lot of our pals didn't even like wrestling. They just done it for something today, like, because all our pals were doing it. But we used to all just basically barter each other about on mattresses. We threw each other off bin sheds. We used to go through bushes and stuff. It was madness. So that's what we done when we were younger, hoping that one day it would become true.
Mm-hmm.
Me and Frankie Richards were the only ones that end up training to become wrestlers. Frankie Richards trained at the Asylum, and I trained at PBW, so we were divided. And then obviously we both left during lockdown, and we're both back now. He trains at Glasgow School of Wrestling in the King Sharp Dojo with myself. So we're training together now, and our friendship's a lot better now than it was in years through wrestling. Basically, Attitude Pro Wrestling became a thing recently because I always had dreams of promoting a wrestling show. I always wanted to be a wrestling promoter. I feel like I can put on a good wrestling card. I used to always, in my free time, I used to write wrestling cards out, storylines. I used to draft rosters and stuff. Do you know what I mean? So I always had dreams of becoming a booker at a wrestling show. So I am kind of seeing all these pop-up promotions pop up. Rivals Pro Wrestling was obviously one of them. I wrestled from the first show. That was my first show back, which was good fun. I got to wrestle the Big Strong Man and stuff. And obviously all the stuff came out about this guy trying to fraud people and stuff. So I just kind of thought, you know something, I think I'm going to run my own wrestling show. I think it's about time I give it a go. The first place that popped up into my mind, obviously, was Rolgan. That's where I grew up. That's the place where we used to wrestle, out our back gardens and stuff. That is like the place. That was always what I had my eyes set on. And there's never been a wrestling show in Rolgan. Never, ever, ever been a wrestling show in Rolgan. The closest there's been a wrestling show in Rolgan is a show in Burnside. I think Source Wrestling used to run Burnside. But I don't think it done well, so I think they stopped doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a few people have run shows in Canvas Line, but you know, I mean, it's not really done well either. But I just think it's not been promoted right. That's how it's not done as well, because it's not had the right promotion done to it. So I've always had my eyes set on doing a show in Rolgan, because there's never been wrestling in Rolgan, and I've always wanted a wrestling show in Rolgan. Since I was a young boy, I've always tried to get shows in Rolgan. I used to always message BCW, like, saying, can you please do a show in Rolgan, please, and all that. But obviously, they do shows in East Kilbride, and they look at Rolgan as a surrounding area, so... Mm-hmm.
If they're going there, they'll come from Brother Glen instead.
Aye, that's his mindset to it. Like, it's only 15 minutes on a bus to get East Kilbride. That's what I always get told. When I ask for a wrestling show in Rolgan. But I'm just surprised nobody's ever done it. So the Glen Cairn, it's a nice venue. It holds 300 people. So I get in contact with the owners. I know the owners personally. So I've spoke to them, and I'm hoping to make this a regular thing. I want to run 3 to 4 shows a year in Rollaghan for now, and then see how I get on. Then I'll look at doing all other areas. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so I want to bring wrestling to the place I grew up, and I'm doing that on May the 5th. I'm putting on a show called A Scheme Wrestling Spectacular that is Ruggie Mania, and I've got a good roster of talent on it. And it's got to be a good show. It's got to be really good.
Excellent. I mean, I'm hoping. I'm taking a break from recordings in May, so I would like to possibly even do a preview show once the full. I mean, there's a fair few matches
course,
already announced.
I'd be up for that. All the matches are announced.
If I don't have time, I'm certainly intending to do a write up preview anyway. So there'll be some sort of preview for the show. But yeah, it's looking good. It's bringing in the guys from Community Pro and from Iron Girders together as well. Of course, there's a Battle Royal as well to face.
Yeah, well, Home Alone, basically, so. I'm just wanting to basically all the people that I'm a fan of in Scottish wrestling are on this show. We've got the Big Strong Man. We've got Saqib Ali. We've got Mayhem Brooks. Mayhem Brooks is amazing. I don't know if you've seen him wrestle before. I'm sure you had him on the show.
Well, he's from Elgin, and that's where I live. So it was.
That's how he's not really used a lot because of how far he stays. A lot of promoters might not want to pay his expenses to get over. But I think he's a really good, talented athlete. I think he's got potential to be one of the best wrestlers in Scotland. And I'm going to give these guys a platform, and I basically want them to get more experience and get better, and you know what I mean, go further in wrestling. It's basically, I'm doing these shows to help other talent out. Like I'm investing in a lot of talent in Scotland. And I feel like they're not getting the recognition that they deserve. And I think this is a great opportunity to create a platform for them. And obviously I've got guys like Ravy Davies, Saqib Ali and Lou King Sharp. Those are guys that have established themselves, and those are guys that can help bring these guys to their level. And that's my goal. My goal is to make these guys stars as well as make myself a star.
Well, I mean, my last question was going to be Radilad Gaz Williams, which is what's your goal professional wrestling? But you've just answered it. is just to make it a better place than you began.
Yes, I'm really invested in making Scottish wrestling a safer place. I'm doing background checks into all my wrestlers. I'm making sure that I'm not booking anyone I shouldn't book. I book people obviously based on their wrestling, but most importantly as a person. I just want good people to be around. I just want to create a good environment. And I feel like everybody that I've got in Ruggie Mania are going to make this a good environment. There's so many names I've got in the show. But all these guys are good guys. Ladies as well, they're all good people, and they, you know what I mean, they just deserve to have a platform, and this is my goal. I want to give them a platform.
Excellent. So yeah, people could go check out. We have the match card going up on our site as well when they're announced. But check out Actu Pro Wrestling. So we'll do that before we wrap it up. Though, we do have our two questions that we ask everyone. Which it seems like a weird way to wrap up the show at this point. but we asked them to everyone, so who'd win the fight? Or what would win the fight? Two sheep or one cow?
Definitely one cow.
This one
sheep can be really aggressive. Fuck me, man.
I know, it's a thinker.
That's a real fight question to ask.
It's a stupid question, but everyone I've asked it for, I mean, you can blame Luke King Sharp for this, because this is how it started. I think Krieger asked Krieger.
That is definitely something that Luke King Sharp would ask someone.
It's one of those questions that apparently that it got asked up that many times that Lou gave up remembering what his answer was. He just picks the opposite of what Krieger would say. Just to get our eyes out of him. So yeah, you've picked a cow, but you know, I'm still believing in my sheep here. And what's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh, it's my favorite dinosaur. Probably a T-Rex.
Classic. That's a classic one.
Just a classic one. I'm kidding on. I'm just saying that because I don't know any other names for dinosaurs.
That's all right. That's all right. We just got questions in for Ruby Roberts, so we'll finish all up right. Those ones, and then we'll plug all the socials. Right. There's two questions here, but one's more important okay. than the other, and I think I know which one it is. Who's your favorite Power Ranger and why?
My favorite Power Ranger.
Yeah.
The green one, because I love the colour green, because I love Celtic.
I wonder if Ruby was asking
but I hate Power Rangers. I think Power Rangers is a lot of shit. I've never liked it.
See, I liked you at the start of this show. No, I've got a little pink Power Ranger.
I like it a wee bit.
That's fine. But no, I was thinking she might be asking that because Green Power Ranger was Jason David Frank. I don't know if she was thinking there was some correlation.
I know Jason David Frank, the martial artist. I know him. He actually died not long ago, I believe.
He did, yeah.
Such a young age as well, he died.
This is the episode, this is a tribute to Jason. No, it's not. But no, I'm a big fan. So Ruby's going to be probably giving you a bit of a scalping for that sort of slander.
Well, apologies for not liking Power Rangers, but if there was a Power Ranger I would like, it's the green one because I love the colour green, obviously. Just a pure biased person.
So we'll finish up then with Ruby's other question and then we'll do the socials. What's next right. for the Wanderer?
What's next for the Wanderer? Well, the Wanderer's going to be the Wanderer's... Oh, what is next for the Wanderer? To get a win in CPW. That's what's next for the Wanderer. To take CPW to the next level and to take Attitude Pro, to get Attitude off the ground. Like, get it kicked off. That's what's next for the Wanderer. The Wanderer's there for the people. The Wanderer's going to go places, and I'm going to make sure of that.
Excellent. So thank you very much for joining me today. Where can people find out more about yourself and about anything else you want to plug, like Attitude Pro Wrestling?
Well, you can follow The Wanderer on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and TikTok now. I still don't know how to work TikTok, but we'll get around to that. But you can follow me on all those platforms at The Wanderer PW. And you can follow Attitude Pro Wrestling on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. You can follow them and keep up to date with all the latest announcements for the roster, matches, shows, etc. That's where you keep up to date with all of Attitude Pro Wrestling stuff. I'd like to give a special shout out to a few people.
Yep.
Ravy Davey, Daryl, Ross, Spider-Man, the Big Strong Man, Mayhem Brooks, Stone Malone, you're all killing it, and keep doing what you're doing.
Excellent, that's nice way to finish up the show, but again, thank you very much
Frankie Richards as well. Shout of course. Frankie Richards.
After all that, after saying he's your best pal, and you almost forgot him at the end there. But no,
he's not really my best pal then, is he? if I didn't see him first.
Probably likes Power Rangers. But anyway, so thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today.